Macmillan Audio presents Incendiary, The Psychiatrist, The Mad Bomber, and The Invention of Criminal Profiling by Michael Cannell. Read for you by Peter Berkrot.
Preface. This is a book about madness. Madness and gunpowder. In these pages lives a serial bomber, a paranoid schizophrenic who, for a long, harrowing stretch of the 1950s, convulsed New York with dread. The nearly three dozen homemade explosives he set off in public places brought into being a culture of fear more than four decades before terrorism became an American fixation. He embodied everything unnerving about the years W.H. Auden called the Age of Anxiety. Whatever cruelty they inflicted, the century's two great wars were at least fathomable. The bomber was not. He was like a dream distortion of post-war disquiet, unhinged, unrelenting, perpetually hidden in city shadows. The bomber had a rightful grievance against an uncaring employer. His resentment transmogrified into a consuming rage. The venom spouted from a dark psychic hole where logic does not go. I correct myself, where normal logic does not go. Schizophrenics follow their own logic. We just don't understand it. The NYPD certainly didn't understand it. The famously tough-minded New York detectives stumbled and fumbled as a harassing band of newspaper reporters detailed at every turn. For more than a century, the police had relied on muscle and shoe leather to collar bad guys. The street corner respected the billy club, and that was that. But the reliable strong-arm methods proved useless in the face of a schizophrenic serial bomber. Seldom in the history of New York, wrote the Associated Press, has a case proved such a torment to police. The bomber's rampage came at a time when science was transforming the way Americans thought about the world around them. Jonas Salk came up with the polio vaccine, eradicating a disease that had crippled hundreds of thousands. Bell Labs paved the way for modern electronics and all that came with it by inventing the silicon transistor. Physicist Edward Teller created the hydrogen bomb. Scientific advancements, however, did not elevate policing. At least not in New York. The NYPD's corrupt precinct captains and stubborn commanders resisted new methods promoted by college-educated criminologists until the serial bomber forced them to adapt. With the manhunt reaching critical urgency, the police took the unprecedented step of asking a psychiatrist what the forensic evidence revealed about the bomber's troubled inner life. What strange sort of person was he, and what wounding life experience led to his murderous avocation? In other words, they asked the psychiatrist to invent a new criminal science, one that would peer into the mind of the bomber. The term profiling would not be coined for another two decades. Until then, the only investigators who had drawn portraits of a criminal's emotional history existed in the stories of Edgar Allan Poe and Sir Arthur Conan Doyle. Sherlock Holmes could size up the evidence and bring blackmailers and assassins to mind with photographic precision. Could a psychiatrist do the same in real life? Could life imitate a murder mystery? Today, art mostly imitates life. Television and movies have so inundated us with fictional accounts of profiling that we easily lose sight of what a breakthrough it was in 1957. Every one of today's profilers, real or televised, traces his or her lineage back to the psychiatrist who depicted the serial bomber with uncanny accuracy. What follows is an account of profiling's beginnings. Everything in these pages is true, including the quotations, though the bomber's thoughts are speculation. Like any resonant story, it contains at its heart an unanswerable question. Can science alone grasp the intricacies of the human mind? Or does true understanding require the reverberative powers of intuition? How does one apprehend the wits of a madman? These questions gripped me as I worked on this book over the past 3 years. Along the way, I came to understand that to write about madness is to write about oneself, however obliquely.
Prologue. December, 1956. Shortly after lunch on a cold December morning in 1956, a trio of New York City detectives stepped out the back door of the copper-domed police headquarters, looming like a dirty gray temple above the tenements and trattorias of Little Italy. Across the street, half shrouded in winter shadow, a revolver-shaped sign hung outside John Jovino's, the oldest gun store in the city, if not the country, where patrolmen bought the .38 specials slung on their hips. Directly above Jovino's hung a fire escape, where Ouija, the dean of tabloid photographers, perched with his boxy black Graflex flashbulb camera for choice views of handcuffed mobsters and murderers dragged in for booking. Down the block, on the corner of Grand Street, was a German restaurant called Headquarters. Under its carved mahogany ceiling, at a lengthy oak bar, the top brass took their off-duty rye and beer. Officers requiring discretion could enter the bar through an underground tunnel. Today, the three detectives had no time for such distractions. Led by a veteran captain, Howard Finney, they walked briskly to an unmarked police cruiser, a big green and white Plymouth, idling at the curb, and drove south through the winding downtown streets on an urgent errand. 4 days earlier, a bomb had exploded during a showing of War and Peace at the Paramount Movie Palace on Flatbush Avenue in Brooklyn. At 7:55 p.m., as an audience of 1,500 gazed up at a St. Petersburg drawing room, rendered in saturated technicolor reds and blues, a thundering detonation flashed from Orchestra Row GG, followed by billows of ash and smoke. For an instant, the air rang with shock, like the hushed moment after a window shatters. Then screams filled the theater, screams of pain, panic, and fright, as moviegoers glimpsed faces and scalps scythed open by shrapnel. The audience sprang to its feet, like worshippers rising in unison for a hymn, and pressed hard for exits, leaving behind six injured. Above them, the glimmering loveliness of Audrey Hepburn in ball gown and tiara waltzed on under the soft blue eyes of Henry Fonda. The Paramount blast was not an isolated event. Any New Yorker who read newspapers knew that for 16 years the police had searched for a serial bomber who identified himself only as F.P. He had planted 32 homemade explosives in the city's most crowded public spaces, theaters, terminals, subway stations, a bus depot, and a library, injuring 15. He timed most of the devices to go off shortly after 5 o'clock p.m., the height of rush hour. F.P. had yet to kill, but it was only a matter of time. The New York Journal American, an afternoon newspaper of scrappy disposition, called him the greatest individual menace New York City ever faced. The capture of a bomb-building psycho with an insatiable, unreasoned grievance, the newspaper said, was the most agonizing challenge of modern times. In all those years, a period stretching back to 1940, The largest, most formidable police force in the world had failed to hustle up any worthy leads. Its failings were easily excusable, as long as the bomber crafted crude and ineffective ordnance. But by 1956, his handiwork showed a lethal new proficiency. He declared his intent to kill in letters sent to newspaper editors. Each rambling, raging letter was cryptically signed FP. The New York mood, already clouded by Cold War anxiety, darkened by the day. With each bomb, the police looked more hapless. The mayor spoke of lawlessness. On the morning after the Paramount explosion, the newly installed police commissioner, Stephen P. Kennedy, ordered the greatest manhunt in the history of the police department. Desperation drove the police to pursue a course they had never before considered in the department's 111-year history. On that late fall afternoon, Captain Finney and his two bomb squad sidekicks left headquarters to call on Dr. James A. Brussell, a psychiatrist with expertise in the workings of the criminal mind. If physical evidence could not lead the police to FP, maybe emotional insights could. A wiry figure with a droll smile and pencil mustache dyed to match his dark combed back hair greeted Captain Finney in the downtown Broadway offices of the New York State Department of Mental Hygiene, where Dr. Brussell served as deputy commissioner. He split time between the department offices and a private psychiatric practice conducted in his home on the grounds of a Queens psychiatric hospital. If Captain Finney was circumspect and grave, Dr. Brussell was the opposite. Loud of opinion, quick-witted, and maniacally animated. Captain Finney emptied a satchel of evidence on Dr. Brussell's desk. Outspilled photographs of unexploded bombs and theater seats ripped open with pocket knives, along with photostats of strangely worded letters and crime scene reports amassed over 16 years. The bombs and the letters, these were all the police had, Dr. Brussell would write. The rest was a mystery. The three detectives barely stirred as Dr. Brussell picked through the evidence, pausing to write notes in a pad. His mind assembled the possibilities as the information accrued. Captain Finney was a short, stocky man of many accomplishments and few words, Dr. Brussell later wrote. He was looking at me, waiting for me to say something. I was looking at the pile of photographs and letters he had tossed on my desk. Dr. Brussell sensed that Captain Finney, a quiet, deep-thinking type, was prepared to listen, no matter how far-fetched the psychiatric feedback might be. The other two bomb squad detectives, on the other hand, barely disguised their skepticism. They looked like caricatures of hardened cops, square-shouldered and thick-chested, with hard-set jaws clouded by 5 o'clock shadow. They rolled their eyes and smirked sideways at each other, like ill-behaved boys dragged to evening prayer. They fidgeted, they sighed, they exchanged glances of alternating amusement and impatience, Dr. Brussell would write. Catching criminals was police work. What could a psychiatrist know about it? To street-hardened detectives, a psychiatrist carried no more weight than a psychic or a fortune teller. Dr. Brussell knew that by venturing a psychiatric assessment of the bomber, what we now call a profile, he would be putting his profession's credibility on the line, and his own. After 2 hours, Dr. Brussell rose from his desk and stood at a window overlooking City Hall. The lowering sun cast weak winter rays on the dark municipal buildings, standing against a blue-gray dusk. 12 stories below, the first surge of rush hour traffic thickened with long-finned sedans and checker cabs clogging Broadway. Streetlights winked on. Chambers Street, filled with men in trench coats and brimmed hats, heads down and shoulders slouched against the cold. They moved with haste, as New Yorkers do. Any one of the people I saw below could have been the mad bomber, Dr. Brussell would write. There was a man standing next to a car. Another man was lounging in a doorway. Another was strolling along, looking up intently at the buildings. Each of them was on these streets at that hour for some reason. Perhaps a legitimate reason, perhaps not. So little was known about the mad bomber that virtually anyone in the city could be picked at random as a suspect. anyone and no one. The manhunt had lasted so long and had engendered so much frustration that Captain Finney and his men had come to feel as if they were chasing a specter loose in the streets. He seemed like a ghost, Dr. Brussel later recalled, but he had to be made of flesh and blood. He had been born, he had a mother and father, he ate and slept and walked and talked. Somewhere people knew him, saw his face, heard his voice. Probably thousands of people in and around New York had some fleeting contact with him at one time or another. He sat next to people on the subways and buses. He strolled past them on sidewalks. He rubbed elbows with them in stores. Though he sometimes seemed to be made of night stuff, unsolid, bodiless, he patently did exist. For a long moment, Dr. Brussel looked as if he had slipped into a trance, as if he was straining to hear a signal in the white noise of the city, a psychic tap, 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 that would lead him to the bomber. While he was staring out at the strangers aswarm in the street, something clarified in Dr. Brussel's mind, like pixels cohering to form a picture. A detailed image of a living, breathing man took shape. He turned to Captain Finney and described his fugitive, right down to the cut of his jacket. Part 1. The Manhunt. Chapter 1. Angel of Justice. October, 1951. 5 years earlier, on the afternoon of October 22nd, 1951, F.P. drove his Daimler sedan 90 miles down the Taconic Parkway, carefully minding the speed limits. If a highway patrolman stopped him, he might have cause for suspicion. The patrolman might frisk F.P., and he might discover the heavy object F.P. carried in his coat pocket. In the earliest days of his bombing campaign, F.P. rode the train to Manhattan, but he felt unbearably conspicuous. He was one of the few male passengers boarding in the hours after the morning commute. The women dressed for city luncheons or matinees shot him suspicious looks. The conductor paused a little too long while punching his ticket, as if to memorize his features. Or so F.P. imagined. He parked the Daimler on Riverside Drive near 96th Street, as he always did, lingering in the driver's seat to slowly, deliberately pour gunpowder from a bottle into a length of pipe steadied between his leather lace-ups. By waiting to arm the bomb, he reduced the chance of an accidental explosion during his drive to the city. He was on foot now, walking among the sober-faced office buildings, standing shoulder to shoulder in Midtown. A wealth of goods filled store windows, shined-up Oxford shoes and woolen suits, Danish living room sets, Dumont televisions in dark wood cabinets. F.P. admired it all, as one covets things one will never have. The sidewalk crowds brushed by F.P., heightening his sense of invisibility. All the while, the live bomb buried deep in the pocket of his overcoat ticked away like a mechanical heartbeat. Soon, the first wave of commuters would march east to Grand Central Terminal and board trains to outlying towns, Bedford, Rye, Darien. Clinking ice buckets and the hugs of pajama-soft children awaited them in ranch homes, set back among the russet leaves of October. No such comforts would greet F.P. He had no job, no real home of his own, no familial warmth. He had none of the consolations he saw depicted on television or in Life magazine ads. What he nurtured instead was a grievance and a growing conviction that he, and he alone, was chosen to be a great avenger, an angel of justice. Standing on the corner of 43rd Street and Broadway, F.P. could see the full neon honky-tonk shine of Times Square pulsating above him. Camel cigarettes, Admiral appliances, Chevrolet. The billboards glimmered and blinked with the wattage of 1,000 light bulbs, as if to compensate for the gloom of a dying afternoon. On the west side of Times Square stood an ornate old movie palace called the Paramount, fronted by an oversized marquee.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.